not set up.
Oh dear.
Not Johnny.
Hafsa, hello Hafsa. Hafsa says, if you were going to make a movie, what would it be called?
We made a movie, for goodness sake. Did you watch it? We made a movie. It was out last year. We were weird game show hosts, but we also, we could be making another movie next year.
Can I be in it?
Yes. No. Would you like to be in it? You can play a
cat. I'll be a dog.
Or a dog. All right, be a dog.
Okay, thank you guys so much for sending in your questions, but make sure you stick around because we have got 12 again coming up right now, and we've got a nice little surprise after that, so we'll see you then.
What's this all about?
Oh, you'll see, lads.
I love
you. You'll see.
Coming up, three celebs become 12 again.
I don't want to be on a battlefield in Scotland.
My mum's calling him.
Perhaps.
It's quite embarrassing, isn't it, really?
And we catch up with superstar singer Nicole Scherzinger.
I was really shy and kind of awkward and lanky.
Want to find out more? Well, have you ever wondered what it would have been like to be best mates with your favourite celebs when they were your age? What did they get up to? What were their favourite songs? And what TV shows did they watch? Because despite the glamorous lifestyles they now lead, once they were a kid with a dream just like you. This show lets you look back in time with your favourite celebs as they become 12 again. She's both live and deadly, and that's just on a Saturday morning.
That was crazy!
But back in 1986, Naomi Wilkinson was a wannabe star.
I was noisy, quite self-confident. Bit of a show off, bit of a chatterbox, and loved singing and dancing.
They may be a chart-topping musical duo now, but back in the noughties were Rizzle Kicks hip-hop heroes.
When I was 12, I was slightly confused, kind of popular, athletic little boy with an afro.
I was quite immature. I wasn't that cool, actually. I was actually quite uncool, thinking about it.
She's the woman who's probably been keeping you awake after Doctor Who on a Saturday night.
The Doctor must think he's winning, right until the trap closes.
But back in 1970, Frances Barber showed no signs of this on-screen villainy.
At 12, I was actually a bit of a goody-goody. I don't quite know how or why, and it all went horribly wrong shortly after that.
It may be superstardom today, but it wasn't always that way. Let's go back and find out what they were like when they were kids.
I used to wear a lot of sloppy jumpers and leggings. That was my kind of usual look.
When I was 12, I had definitely had an afro, and the older kids all thought I was cool because I had an afro. Pretty much afro got me everywhere. In fact, my nickname was Minifro.
I always just had a shaved head. It was like completely no hair. I've quite an odd shaped head, so like it would just look really weird.
I had these pink socks, and I don't know where, I've got older brothers, I think they were their football socks or something. So I took to wearing those after my first year at school, and I was known as Frankie with the pink socks. And I always had them on, so they must have really smelled, because I don't ever remember ever taking them off. I had them on 5 days a week, so I must have bombed.
I wasn't in the cool gang, I wasn't in the complete geek gang, I think I was just in the middle. No, maybe I was. Maybe I was just quite square, actually. Maybe more the square end.
So apart from figuring out where they fitted in at school, what else was life like for our celebrities?
I went to a school where the masters still wore their gowns, like in Harry Potter. All the boys at school, they were revolting. So we'd rather read the Bunty, go horse riding at my friend's house, and that was it, you know. We thought boys were revolting, really.
Loads of girls in the year above told me they fancied me and I didn't understand. Then I got older, like a year older, and I just suddenly realised, and I was like trying to go back to them, and I was just like, oh no, we liked you last year. No.
Silly Billy.
I was silly. But I think, you know what it was though, the irony is that I reckon if I wasn't oblivious, I wouldn't have had so much attention.
I didn't have a boyfriend when I was 12, but I did have a big crush on Ralph Macchio, the Karate Kid. Oh, Oh, this is just like the picture I had in my desk. I loved him.
You say Macho, I say Macho. Either way, he was the original Karate Kid. Before Will Smith's son Jaden took over in 2010.
Every single holiday we ever had was around Britain. So we would have sort of history lesson holidays up to Scotland, and we'd have history lessons about the Battle of Culloden and Braveheart and William Wallace and things like that. Going, I want to be on a battlefield in Scotland. I want to be on a beach in Ibiza.
You aren't alone, Francis. In the 1970s, Ibiza wasn't the place to be seen. Everybody wanted a week's break in a British seaside holiday camp. Back then, sunbathing wasn't top of the priority list. You had your activities all planned out by the smartly dressed holiday reps.
Wayne, glamorous grandmother. Marion, knobbly knees.
You heard it right. It was traditional for men to compete to see who had the knobbliest knees, but only when they went on holiday.
Lisa, you'll be on Donkey Derby.
Well, the Donkey Derby was clearly lots more fun than the glamorous grandmother competition. The biggest problem of summer holidays in the 70s was stopping your dad from embarrassing the entire family.
Unbelievable.
While Francis wanted to escape from dodgy family holidays at 12, what did Naomi dream of as a kid?
This is a book I wrote about my ambitions. And it's quite embarrassing, isn't it, really? When I'm older, my ambition is to be something to do with theatre, like acting, dancing, modelling or doing makeup. I would like to do this because I do dancing. I would like to appear on television and get lots of money. I would have 3 children, 2 girls and 1 boy. I will have 1 husband. My pets will be a dog, 2 cats and a gerbil. I would like to have my ears pierced and have lots of earrings. So those were my ambitions.
And Naomi wasn't the only person interested in creative writing at 12.
I did write a song called The Simple Beat. Not too rough, not too neat. Not too posh, but not too street. Not too quick, but it moves the feet. It's the simple beat, the simple beat. Music makes the world go round. Not money, even though I wouldn't mind a pound. Everywhere is where music can be found, whether it's on the street and the underground. Music is a chemical. It's life and living in a compound. That's actually a scientific reference. I was bursting with knowledge when I was younger. I've just got less intelligent as I've grown older.
So now we know what our celebs were like when they were kids. But what was everyone listening to when they were 12?
We didn't download music, didn't have MP3s and 3 players and stuff. We had record players. You had to sort of put the record on the machine and carefully lower the record needle down. I was so slow.
So when Naomi eventually got the music started back in 1986, what was she listening to?
The Way You Make Me Feel, Michael Jackson. Who's That Girl, Madonna. Bruce Willis, Under the Boardwalk, Shakin' Stick.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. What was that? Let's go back one.
Bruce Willis, Under the Boardwalk.
Surely that can't be Hollywood action hero Bruce Willis, star of blockbuster movies like Armageddon.
Yeah, I mean, believe it or not, Bruce Willis, that action hero that we know today, had a very cheesy pop career as well.
Nice one, Bruce. But you should definitely stick to the acting. So that was 1987, but what was Francis listening to back in 1970?
Having older brothers and sisters, you obviously tend to hear things they're listening to, and they were all listening to Mark Bolan. I remember singing that at school, thinking it was just amazing because he wore makeup. And we'd never seen a man ever wear makeup before. So that was quite a massive thing, actually.
Mark Bolan was the lead singer of T-Rex, one of the most popular glam rock bands of the decade. But they weren't alone. Glam rock was huge, and exactly what you'd expect from the name. Rock music performed by men in glamorous outfits. Some of the time. The hair was big, the platforms were high, and the flares were pretty wide. Glam rock is what 12-year-olds were listening to back then. Oi! So let's bring things a little bit more up to date and find out what the Rizzle Kicks were listening to back in the noughties.
Well, when I was 12, I was listening to Dizzy Rascal's first album, Boy in the Corner. Sweet like Tropicana. When the hammer hits your head, splits like banana. You're not ready for this, you better send your best. Dizzy Rascal was actually an artist who was introduced to me by my mother on the way to school. She's like, have you heard of this Dizzy Rascal yet, Jordan? And then I hadn't been brought up by like the Queen or anything, but. And then I was like, no, I don't know what you're talking about. And she was like, chorus goes, just a rascal, just a rascal, just a rascal, Dizzy Rascal. Definitely not a hustle, black, definitely I win. So you keep taking this for a job, I'll definitely just grin. Definitely and I went, alright, cool, that sounds good. And then I got to school and everyone was like, oh, you heard Dizzy Rascal? And I was like, yeah, yeah, the one that goes, just a rascal. And they're like, yeah, and I was like, yeah, sick. And then I went and bought the album, so.
And no one knew that my mum was sort of cooler than him.
Perhaps.
I was listening to a lot of Nirvana at that time. I thought I was being cool. I was like, yeah, I like a band from like when I wasn't even born yet.
Nirvana went global in 1991, the year Harley was born, and introduced the world to grunge music. It's a good job that the Rizzles were listening to some cool music, because when they were 12, a song with a particularly dodgy dance move was sweeping the nation.
DJ Casper. This is something new, the Casper Slide Part 2. Slide to the left.
Crisscross. Two hops this time.
This song was unbelievably one of the biggest singles of the year, but it's not the first time Daft Dance has invaded the charts. Here's some of the best and worst. First up, it's the Gap Band with their song Oops Upside Your Head. Accompanied not so much by a dance, just more sitting on your bum and waving. Next up, it's the Tweets and the Birdie song. Is it just me or is this absolutely terrifying? Now, you'll know this song from parties, but it's actually an 80s classic by Black Lace. Superman was considered pretty cool back then. Just look at all these fully grown adults taking the moves very seriously. Grow up. The 90s were only a little bit better for novelty dance songs. There was the Macarena. Then Steps came along with their version of line dancing. Terrible, in a sort of good way. Still to come, we catch up with international pop superstar Nicole Scherzinger.
I was really shy and kind of awkward and lanky, and I guess I got teased a little, and my nickname was Crybaby because I was very sensitive.
And we find out what TV gold our celebs are watching when they were 12.
The things he did were crazy. What kind of name is B.D. Baxter?
Dick and Dom in the Bungalow.
Dick and Dom in the Bungalow.
But first, let's see what big moments had an impact on our celebrities when they were 12.
When I was 12, it was Euro 2004.
England faced Portugal, the hosts of Euro 2004, in just a few hours' time. It's another crucial match. If England lose, they're out.
I wonder what happens here.
England went out to penalties, in penalties, to Portugal.
Hi, welcome to the programme. Our top stories this afternoon. Down and out in Lisbon, the England team are on their way home.
This afternoon, the England players packed their bags and flew out of Portugal. They're all bitterly disappointed, of course, at missing out again. And all everyone here is talking about is what on earth went wrong.
Euro 2004 should have been a great year for England. Their star player Wayne Rooney became the youngest scorer in the competition's history. Unfortunately, an injury to his foot took him out of the quarterfinal match against Portugal, and the penalty shootout ended England's dreams.
I was at a friend's house watching that game with loads of people, and I remember just everyone just sitting there afterwards just really depressed. But the good thing that happened about that game is that because we're all so depressed, the girl's mum then said, oh, as you're all so upset, we can have a party here tonight. And we had a party at her house, which was good.
Awesome.
So let's find out what the big story was for Frances in 1971.
Welcome to our special programme this afternoon that we're calling D-Day minus one. D, of course, standing for decimals.
The thing I remember that was big news when I was 12 the most was when we changed from old coinage to decimalisation.
Until 1971, the United Kingdom was one of the last places in the world not using a modern money system.
Here are a threepenny bit and three old pennies.
If you think threepenny bit sounds a bit funny, there was also a shilling, half a crown, a sixpence and a halfpenny. Confused? Well, basically, back then the pound had 240 old pence in it. Simple.
I couldn't work that out. I'd be going... And it was that those kind of maths lessons just filled me with such misery and horror.
So to bring us up to date and make things a lot simpler, a whole new set of coins were introduced.
1 pound is 100 new pennies, 100 new pence to the pound.
The problem was converting the price of everything from old money to new money.
All of a sudden, it was just 10 pennies in 10p. It wasn't 2 and 6 and half a crown and a sixpence and a threepenny bit and a whatever it was that just made me want to cry. It was just fantastic.
Frances may have welcomed the change, but for some people it was a bit like if we changed from the pound to the euro overnight. Not everyone was happy.
How are you getting on with the new coin, sir?
Well, it's just terrible.
Are you able to do your shopping?
Well, you're just going to do no shopping. And that's it, finished.
My gran was livid. Well, Frances' big moment at 12 was here in the UK. For Naomi, in 1986, a tragedy in America left a lasting impression.
In the worst disaster in manned spaceflight, America's shuttle has exploded, and the 7 crew are presumed dead.
When I was 12, one of the big stories I remember happening was the spaceship Challenger exploding.
The space shuttle missions began in 1981 and were unique because the shuttles could land back on Earth and be used again. The Challenger mission was special because one of the astronauts, Christa McAuliffe, was the first member of the Teacher in Space project. After the disaster, no more shuttles launched for almost 3 years.
I can remember seeing that on the news quite vividly and just thinking how utterly devastating it was to watch, to think that there were people on board that. It was terrible.
But it was a personal loss that stands out as Naomi's biggest moment of the year.
A big thing that happened when in my 12th year was that I lost both grandparents from my mum's side. In 1 year, it was pretty tough. I was very sad to have lost my grandparents so young, but I have lovely memories of my grandparents, and they're not gone forever, they're still with you.
Still to come, we ask the all-important question, what would our celebs do if they were 12 again?
I'd make myself dress differently. I'd tell myself what to learn, what to do, who to talk to, like when just to shut up.
I'd probably say the world is your oyster.
I'd do the same if I was 12 again. I'm getting sad now because I think maybe 12 is the best year of my life.
Before that, we have got 2 minutes with Nicole Scherzinger to discover what she was like when she was 12.
I grew up in Louisville, Kentucky, a southern town in America. Being a Hawaiian, Ukrainian, Filipina girl, not many people looked like me. I was really shy and kind of awkward and lanky, and I guess I got teased a little, and my nickname was Crybaby because I was very sensitive.
A former pussycat doll and now a solo megastar, music has always been a big part of Nicole's life.
My way of like communicating with people was through music. I wanted to be Paula Abdul. But she was so cool because growing up, I didn't have a lot of people where I was from who had my skin color looked different. And she was unique and she was beautiful and she was a great dancer and just had a really great spirit about her.
With a love of music and dance, Nicole was always destined to follow in our hero's footsteps.
I actually went to a youth performing arts high school, so it was something kind of like Glee, actually. Me and my friends were always singing. We'd have like musical theater night. It's kind of nerdy, but it kept us out of trouble. And it was nice to be able to find a crowd that shared the same likes and passions. If I were 12 again and relive any moment, I was on stage and I remember I was the understudy to the guy who was supposed to sing and he didn't show up. So they kicked me out there on stage and I sang and everybody stood up. And I couldn't believe that they actually stood up and they were applauding for me. And I said, wow, this is where I feel the most comfortable is up here. And people, you know, actually liked it. So I would love to relive that moment again. That was really special.
Let's get back to business and find out what Naomi, Frances and Rizzle Kicks were watching when they were 12.
I definitely did watch Dick and Dom in the Bungalow.
Dick and Dom in the Bungalow. Go, go, Dick and
Dom. Hey, who doesn't love Dick and Dom in the Bungalow with classic games like the Mucky Puddle Power Shower Game, Creamy Muck Muck and Grasping Rasping Wrinklies? There's so much to enjoy, but what did the Rizzle Kicks like the best?
Bogies.
It's the pick of the show, cause we're gonna shout bogeys till we're banned from every building in the world.
Bogeys! They go into a public place with a bogeyometer.
Welcome to the fabulous Mitchell Library here in Glasgow. And Wood starts us off with an almost inaudible bogey.
Bogeys.
McCourt raising the volume 1.1.
And they just go like, bogeys. And everyone goes, bogeys. And then it gets louder and louder until they just scream bogeys.
Bogeys.
Wood straight back in with a 1.5. Very, very tight at this stage of the game. Small margins of increase. So 1.5 to beat from a court.
Bogeys.
He's done it. That's a 1.8.
That genuinely ruined like a lot of 12-year-old school careers, because we spent a lot of the class just shouting bogeys and got a lot of detentions. That has purely come from Dick and Dom.
Now, the serious business in hand.
Bogeys!
That was a brave bogey. It's a 4.2, and the crowd getting to their feet delighted with the audacity of Wood's tactics there. And it seems McCourt has lost his bottle. Yes, he concedes and hands the match to Wood. What a marvellous victory. Let's see that winning bogey one more time.
Bogeys!
As well as watching shows like Da Bungalow, the Rizzles were fans of the big talent shows of the time, such as Fame Academy, which is like a cross between Big Brother and The X Factor.
Celebrity Fame Academy is one of the best like thing ever. Always remember Ruby Wax coming out and just doing like the worst rendition of a song, and it was just amazing.
Sorry about this, it is not good.
I come home in the morning light. My mother says, when you gonna live your life right? Oh mother dear, we're not the fortunate one, and girls just wanna have fun.
Let's stop you right there, Ruby. As we turn back time over 30 years and see what telly Frances was watching in 1970.
The children's TV programmes I remember watching religiously was Blue Peter. I mean, and that was the one thing that you always wanted to come to London, because you saw where Blue Peter was at the beginning of the show. And that's where the dogs were, and Petra, and all. I mean, you know, it was just thrilling to think there they were.
Hello.
Hello.
Bizarrely, the thing that Frances remembers the most about the show wasn't the Blue Peter pets, the do-it-yourself arts and crafts, or even them randomly digging holes in the ground.
Well, we've been digging quite a big hole here.
It was actually the name in the closing credits.
I remember in those days saying to my mum, what kind of name is B.D. Baxter? It just sounded so exotic and so fantastic.
Biddy Baxter was in charge of Blue Peter from 1965 to 1988 and introduced many of the elements we still see in the show today, like the Blue Peter badge.
I wanted to be called Biddy for ages and ages and ages.
Well, Biddy Barber does have a nice ring to it. Let's move forward to 1986 and find out what Naomi was watching at 12.
I remember Duncan Dares very well. I remember him from Blue Peter doing lots of crazy stunts.
Way before Helen Skelton, there was Peter Duncan. The action man of kids' TV in the 80s. Peter joined Blue Peter in 1980 and quickly became the show's resident daredevil.
Now, just stand inside the seat there. That's it. Now.
You kind of forget where you are for a minute, don't you?
Yeah, we're going.
Then it just sort of went a whole league more dramatic with Duncan Dares.
If it was dangerous, Mr. Duncan did it.
Yeah, the things he did were crazy.
I decided my best tactic was to try and trick him into losing his balance. It didn't work.
He went fast, crashed stuff, and got set on fire. So please, don't try this at home. So those were the TV memories of our three celebs, but what do they remember most about being 12?
The best thing about being 12, I think, is probably not being 11.
There are so many changes happening at that time. You are starting to make decisions at school that might affect your future. Your body's starting to change. You're starting to get interested in boys.
It's just like the hardest part of your life, like, because you're just becoming a teenager and everyone else is just becoming teenagers and people becoming teenagers quicker than you. It's weird.
It's weird, yeah, really weird.
When you get into your teens, then you do start to sort of notice boys, fashion. You want to look a certain way. But at 12, it isn't like that. Sadly, what you want at 12 is to be 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. This is what you want. If only they knew to get 12 for a bit longer.
If I was 12 again, I think what I would do is not stop myself from playing violin, which would be awesome if I played now.
If I was 12, I wouldn't have stopped skateboarding, because skateboarding now, if you're good, is really cool.
Yeah, and that's always been cool.
I'd do the same if I was 12 again. I'm getting sad now because I think maybe 12 was the best year of my life.
I'd tell myself what to learn, what to do, who to talk to, like when just to shut up, what not to eat, like everything.
If I could say something to my 12-year-old self, I'd say, wash those stinking pink socks that you wore for probably a year.
If I could talk to my 12-year-old self, I'd probably say, the world is your oyster. Whatever you want to do, go for it. Have a go. What's the worst that can happen?
I think 12's a really fantastic age to be. I'd quite like to be 12 again.
Nah, that's nice. So long as you get some new socks, so Francis, eh? So what have we learned? Well, if you're a Hollywood action hero, leave the singing to the pop stars. Oh, not dancing as well. Also, beware of dads. This shameful display may be ancient, but dads don't change. They can embarrass you without a minute's warning. And if you want to annoy everyone in a library, just do this.
Bogies!
Classic.